भगवद गीता चैप्टर 3 टेक्स्ट 26 न बुद्धि भेदं जनयेत् अज्ञानां कर्मसंगिनां जोषयेत् सर्वकर्माणि विद्वान् युक्तः समाचरन्। ना डू नॉट बुद्धि भेदम डिसरप्ट द इंटेलिजेंस जनयेत डू अज्ञानाम ऑफ द फूलिश कर्म संगिनाम अटैच टू फ्रूटिव वर्क जोशयेत डोवटेल सर्व ऑल कर्माणि वर्क विद्वान लर्नड युक्तः ऑल एंगेज्ड समाचरण प्रैक्टिसिंग। ट्रांसलेशन एंड पर्पोर्ट बाय डिवाइन ग्रेस एसी भक्तिवेदांत स्वामी श्रील प्रभुपाद की जय। Translation, let not the wise disrupt the minds of the ignorant who are attached to fruitive action. They should not be encouraged to refrain from work, but to engage in work in the spirit of devotion. Please repeat, let not the wise disrupt the minds of the ignorant who are attached to fruitive action. They should not be encouraged to refrain from work, but to engage in work in the spirit of devotion. Purport. Vedaischa sarvair ahameva vedyah. That is the end of all Vedic rituals. All rituals, all performances of sacrifices, and everything that is put into the Vedas, including all directions for material activities, are meant for understanding Krishna, who is the ultimate goal of life. But because the conditioned souls do not know anything beyond sense gratification, they study the Vedas to that end. Through sense regulations, however, one is gradually elevated to Krishna consciousness. Therefore, a realized soul in Krishna consciousness should not disturb others in their activities or understanding, but he should act by showing how the results of all work can be dedicated to the service of Krishna. The learned Krishna conscious person may act in such a way that the ignorant person working for sense gratification may learn how to act and how to behave. Although the ignorant man is not to be disturbed in his activities, still a slightly developed Krishna conscious person may directly be engaged in the service of the Lord without waiting for other Vedic formulas. For this fortunate man, there is no need to follow the Vedic rituals, because in direct Krishna consciousness one can have all the results simply by following the prescribed duties of a particular person. Na buddhi bhedam janayed agyanam karma sanginam joshayed sarva karmani vidvan yukta samacharan. So this is a very interesting verse both for the neophyte, the beginner in the practice of Krishna consciousness, and also for the preacher of Krishna consciousness. How preaching has to be done. So Krishna is giving here the advice how preaching has to be done. If a person is very attached materially, to ask him to give up everything and say take sannyas, it's not recommended here. Because he does not have any experience in this field. So instead of asking them to give up work, they should be encouraged to work in the spirit of devotion. So this actually is more elaborately explained in the 12th chapter of Bhagavad Gita. I'll just take you there. Especially from the 6th verse onwards. This is from the 12th chapter of Bhagavad Gita, verses 6 and 7. ಯೇತು ಸರ್ವಾಣಿ ಕರ್ಮಾಣಿ ಮಯಿ ಸನ್ಯಸ್ಯ ಮತ್ಪರಾಹ ಅನನ್ಯೇನೈವ ಯೋಗೇನ ಮಾಂ ಧ್ಯಾಯಂತ ಉಪಾಸತೆ ತೇಷಾಂ ಅಹಂ ಸಮುದ್ಧರ್ತ ಮೃತ್ಯು ಸಂಸಾರ ಸಾಗರಾತ್ ಭವಾಮಿ ನ ಚಿರಾತ್ ಪಾರ್ಥ ಮಯ್ಯಾವೇಶಿತ ಚೇತಸಾಂ. Translation: But those who worship me, giving up all their activities unto me and being devoted to me without deviation, engaged in devotional service and always meditating upon me, having fixed their minds upon me, O son of Pritha, for them I am the quick, I am the swift deliverer from the ocean of birth and death. So for one who is completely Krishna conscious, who has dedicated all his mind, words and action to Krishna, for him, Krishna is the swift deliverer from the ocean of birth and death. So what if one cannot do that? What if one cannot completely surrender? Okay, so this is still continuing in the process of surrender. Mayeva mana adhatsva mai buddhim niveshaya nivasishyasi mayeva ata urdhvam na samshaya. Just fix your mind upon me, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and engage all your intelligence in me. Thus you will live in me always without a doubt. So this is the highest recommendation. This is what we have to come to. Even though we are not on this stage, we should know that this is the perfectional stage. Not that, nice, Krishna has asked the preachers, you know, these Hare Krishna devotees who are talking so much, Krishna has asked them to not disturb me, and you know, let them obey him and not disturb me. I'll be where I am. No. So this has to be taken in the right manner. So we should always desire perfection. But for a person who is not on the stage, who can take advanced leaps, he is at least encouraged to start somewhere, because even a little bit progress in this path is never lost. I'll just go there and come back. See, neha bhikrama nashosti pratyavayo navidyate svalpamapyasya dharmasya trayate mahato bhayat. So of course one has to surrender to Krishna completely, but if one cannot do so, whatever little he does is still not a loss. In this endeavor, there is no loss or diminution, and a little advancement on this path can protect one from the most dangerous type of fear. So even in this life, if we only did, instead of surrendering 100%, maybe we did 0.5%, the next life we will start from 0.6 and continue from where we have left. So that whatever advancement was done is never lost. Whereas if you analyze materially, if one is even a big PhD in this life, next life you have to start from ABCD again. It's lost. So in devotional life, nothing is lost. So going back, so the full advice is that one has to completely surrender. Now, ಅಥ ಚಿತ್ತಂ ಸಮಾಧಾತುಂ ನ ಶಕ್ನೋಷಿ ಮಯಿ ಸ್ಥಿರಂ ಅಭ್ಯಾಸ ಯೋಗೇನ ತತೋ ಮಾಂ ಇಚ್ಛಾಪ್ತುಂ ಧನಂಜಯ. ಮೈ ಡಿಯರ್ ಅರ್ಜುನ, ಓ ವಿನ್ನರ್ ಆಫ್ ವೆಲ್ತ್, ಇಫ್ ಯು ಕ್ಯಾನಾಟ್ ಫಿಕ್ಸ್ ಯುವರ್ ಮೈಂಡ್ ಅಪಾನ್ ಮೀ ವಿಥೌಟ್ ಡಿವಿಯೇಷನ್, ದೆನ್ ಫಾಲೋ ದ ರೆಗ್ಯುಲೇಟಿವ್ ಪ್ರಿನ್ಸಿಪಲ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಭಕ್ತಿ ಯೋಗ. ಇನ್ ದಿಸ್ ವೇ ಡಿವೆಲಪ್ ಅ ಡಿಸೈರ್ ಟು ಅಟೈನ್ ಮೀ. ಸೊ ಫಸ್ಟ್ ದೇರ್ ಇಸ್ ಕಂಪ್ಲೀಟ್ ಲವ್ ಫಾರ್ ಕೃಷ್ಣ. So, but if we don't have that, all right, then you follow the rules set by the spiritual master, Acharya Upasanam, like we have in this movement. One should chant a minimum of 16 rounds of Hare Krishna on the mala. One round is 108 times Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. So this is one mantra, and 108 times is one round, one mala. And 16 malas one have to chant every day. That is the rule number one. And the regulations. Rule means what you should do. Regulations means what you should not do. So, rules and regulations. So, regulations, no meat eating. Includes seafood, fish, egg. Even to the point of onion and garlic. Which is actually, if you see the Manu Samhita and other literatures, you will find that they are actually equivalent to meat. So, no meat eating, no illicit sex, that means no sexual connections outside of marriage, and even within marriage, for procreation of nice children, Krishna conscious population. Then, no intoxication. No intoxication means no smoking, no alcohol, we understand, but even no tea and coffee, Coca-Cola, which has caffeine, and even what is the other one? Mountain Dew, I think. Red Bull, all these things. Can't drink. Then finally, there is no gambling. No gambling. So these four things, regulations and the rules, chanting 16 rounds minimum. But to maintain this, one has a whole program. Because to maintain this standard, we have to have a support system. We have to come to the mode of goodness. And for that, there is Mangalarti. There is the morning program, hearing of the message of Bhagavad Gita and Srimad Bhagavatam on a regular basis. Regular means every day. Nityam. Regular means not like once a week. No, no. Not our own regularization. By the Guru again. Everything. In spiritual life, there is no independent programs. If you do our independent program, then we cannot go to Krishna. Because if we want to go to His abode, we have to play by His rules. Just like many of you are immigrants who have come here. So you have to play by the Singapore rules. What they asked, you know, you have to produce that. You have to qualify. Qualify means, I am not the decision maker. Somebody else has put the standard, and I have to qualify for that standard. It's not that if I like, I will do this way. If I don't like, I will do that way. No, no, no. If in the material world it is so strict, why do we think that in the spiritual aspect, one can do anything one likes, you know? You know, Krishna is very kind, you know, God knows. Yeah, He knows that we are not serious. He knows. He knows us far too well. If we are serious, we will do anything for Him. We cannot give the excuse that, oh, Krishna knows. Yeah, He knows. He knows that we don't deserve to go back to Godhood. If we make the kind of excuses. So, we have to be serious. So, here He is saying that if you cannot fix your mind on Me, then you follow the regulative principles given by the Acharya. Now, we are chanting 16 rounds. It is not that we have great taste for chanting. At least I don't have. You know what is great taste for chanting? Haridas Thakur. He used to chant 192 rounds every day. <laughs> 16 times 12 192 rounds. Every day without fail, whole life. And in the end of life, he was very old. So old, his body was becoming invalid. And he was chanting about 100 something rounds. Then Chaitanya Mahaprabhu went to pay a visit to him. So God is coming to visit him, you know. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu used to, because he was born in a Muslim family, he was not allowed in the Jagannath Puri temple. But the same Jagannath, what is that? Jai Gaura, Shai Krishna, Shai Jagannath. All same. Who is Gaura, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, is Krishna, is Jagannath. All same. That Gauranga Mahaprabhu used to come and visit him every day. And one day when he was old like that, he could not. He was actually lying down and chanting. He could not even sit up. But he did not stop chanting. He did not give an excuse, oh, I cannot sit, you know. Krishna will understand. No, he was chanting. And then Chaitanya Mahaprabhu saw he was not well. Actually, he was going to go away from this world. So, he asked Haridas Thakur, what happened to you? Are you not well? And Haridas Thakur said, yes, I am in a diseased condition. What is the disease? The disease is that I am not able to complete my rounds, my 192 rounds. He did not say that I have one headache, I have one stomach ache, I have one, you know, leg pain. No. My disease is that I am not able to finish my 192 rounds of chanting every day. Then, of course, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, you are so old and you have already attained liberation, you can now reduce your rounds. So, but you know, he never, even God asked him to reduce, he did not want to reduce. Here we are looking for every opportunity to reduce our service. How we can cut corners, you know. No, but serious devotee, if you are serious about going back, then even if Krishna asks you to stop, you will not stop serving him. You know, the Jay and Vijay, who were the doorkeepers of Vaikuntha, they were cursed by the Kumaras. You know the story, right? Then they came here as demons, Hiranyaksha, Hiranyakashipu, three times. And then first is Hiranyaksha, Hiranyakashipu. Then there is Ravana and Kumbhakarna. Then Shishupala and Dantavakra. So three times they came. And they also made a guest special cameo appearance in Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's Leela as Jagayan Madhaya. So they were cursed by the sages. And the sages said, you do not fit to stay in this spiritual world, Vaikuntha. You go to the material world. Then they trembled, you know, please don't curse us like this, you know. Then the Lord came to see what was happening, commotion. Then he saw, then, all right, I cannot prove their word wrong because they are my great devotees, but you are also my great devotees. So, how to adjust the situation? All right, I'll give you a choice. You go to the material world and then after that you will come back to me. But you have two choices. Either you go as for seven lives, very long lives, and be known as the greatest preachers of my message, and thus deliver the whole world with your glorification of me. That means they will be big acharyas. Or you take three lives, be the worst demons you can be, always against me, but always thinking of me in enmity, and be killed by me and come back to me. Which one you want? In the first option, you will have a lot of reputation in the world and everybody will respect you as great acharyas. But in the second world, you will be known as rascals for the eternity. So they said, no, we will be rascals for eternity. We will come back to you. We want three lives, three short lives and untimely death. You know, they did not stay until old age. All these three, Hiranyakashipu, Hiranyaksha, Ravana Kumbhakarna and Shishupala Dantavakra, all were killed. We want to be, our life has to be reduced, cut short, and we want to come back quickly. You see how they were so anxious. Even though they have to go away from Krishna, they cannot go away for long. They come back. So a devotee will never give up his service. So like that, Haridas Thakur did not give up. That is taste. Sri Rupa Goswami also. He is describing how he has taste. Actually, we will go to the Namagana Sadaruchi. Okay. So, this is by Rupa Goswami in the Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu. The symptoms of a person who is really advanced in Krishna consciousness. Kshantir avyartha kalatvam viraktir manashunyata ashabandaha samutkantha namagane sadaruchihi. This is the one we want to highlight. Asaktistad gunakhyane pritistad vasatisthale ityadayonu bhavasyur jata bhavankure jane. When the seed of ecstatic emotion for Krishna fructifies, the following nine symptoms manifest in one's behavior. Forgiveness, concerned, the time should not be wasted. Detachment, absence of false prestige, hope, eagerness, a taste for chanting the holy name of the Lord, attachment to descriptions of the transcendental qualities of the Lord, and affection for those places where the Lord resides, that is, a temple or a holy place like Vrindavan, these are all called anubhava, subordinate signs of ecstatic emotion. They are visible in a person in whose heart the seed of love of God has begun to fructify. Each of these symptoms we can actually go into in depth, but we don't have that much time. You know, concern that time should not be wasted, you know, means what? That Prahlad Maharaj says, Kaumara Acharet Prajna, our human life, we have to start at 5 years old, Dharman Bhagavataniha. Don't waste time. Don't wait until you are old. At 5 years old, begin. This is called concern that time should not be wasted. On a macro level, life scale level, but even on daily basis, devotee is not inclined to just sit idly and do nothing and waste his time. No. He's always looking how to engage, how to engage. Like Goswamis, they did not want to even sleep. They did not want to eat. They just want to serve Krishna. They hardly slept 2 hours every day. So we have to be inspired by these examples. Of course, we cannot imitate. We cannot, if we immediately imitate, we will get sick. Reduce our sleep. Even to chant more. You know? If actually one chants, try to chant 192 rounds, he will get sick. Because he's not on the level of, you know, devotion. So we should do what the spiritual master asks us to do, a minimum of 16 rounds. He did not say only 16 rounds. If you can chant more, you can chant more. Don't do over, you know, like one devotee was Prabhupada's disciple. He was in Vrindavan. He was, he had his own place and he was chanting suddenly 64 rounds. So then devotees used to go and meet him and, you know, he used to say, from yesterday I have been chanting 64 rounds. Oh, wow. Everybody was, you know, congratulating him. And then they came back to Prabhupada, you know, and when they were in the course of the day, when they had the opportunity, they told him, Prabhupada, you know, this particular devotee is chanting 64 rounds since yesterday. Prabhupada said, good. Then about 3 days, 4 days later, then I'm chanting now 108 rounds every day. Then when the devotees came back and told this, then he said, Prabhupada said, as long as he's saying I'm doing this, I'm doing that, he's going to surely fall down. And maximum 1 week later, he was nowhere to be found, gone. Left the movement and we left, completely left, never to be found again. So if we artificially do with full pride, oh, I'm doing this, actually as devotee will never really tell what he's doing. He'll never tell, he'll never advertise his devotion. And so that is another level, but we have to always desire that. At the same time, we should do best what is within our means, best of our capacity. Don't say that within my means I can only do this much. No, that means we are limiting. We have to do as much as we can. So now, I'll take you to the other verse. You have seen, right? The taste for chanting the holy name. Now we'll see what is taste. This is by Rupa Goswami. Tunde tanda viniru ratim vitanute tundavali labdhaye karna kroda kadam vini ghatayate karnarbudebhya spriham chetah prangana sangini vijayate sarvendriyanam kritim no jane janita kiyadbhiramritai Krishneti Varnadvai. I do not know how much nectar the two syllables Krishna have produced. When the holy name of Krishna is chanted, it appears to dance within the mouth. We then desire many, many mouths. Tundavali. Many, many means not 60, 70. It's in the avali means in the regions of millions and billions. That is like Deepavali means many lamps, Deepa. No. In the millions. When that name enters the holes of the ears, we desire many millions of years. When we are hearing, we want to, you know, some people actually come to the kirtan and, oh, so loud. They close their ears. The 2 years only they have, that also they want to close. They don't want to hear the holy name. Actually, loud chant, Krishna, what is that? Krishnot kirtana gana nartana parao. Utkirtana means loud chanting of Krishnot kirtana, Krishna's name. That is very auspicious. The louder, the better. Of course, when you are chanting japa, that is silent. Not that, don't go and shout from tomorrow. In the MRT, everybody will beat you up with shoes. Japa is to be done softly. But kirtan, utkirtana. So, we then desire many millions of years. So this is how you see how much taste he has to chant, to hear about the holy name. He does not want anything else. And when the holy name dances in the courtyard of the heart, it conquers the activities of the mind and therefore all the senses become inert. So this is called taste. And when we don't have this, then we go to 12.9. We take shelter of this verse. Atha chittam samadhatum nashaknoshi mayi sthiram abhyasa yogena tato mam ichchaptum dhananjaya. My dear Arjuna, O winner of wealth, if you cannot fix your mind upon me without deviation, then follow the regulative principles of Bhakti Yoga. So at least this we can do. In this way, develop a desire to attain me. Don't just do, my father asked me to do, you know. Not like this. We have to develop a desire to attain Krishna. Not because of somebody is seeing, that's why I have to do. Somebody is not saying, I'll do something else. But don't forget, Paramatma is always seeing us. In dark, in full darkness also, he is seeing us. So, even when we are asleep, when we don't know ourselves, he knows us. So, we cannot really be out of his sight. So, in this way, develop a desire to attain. We have to be sincere. The whole thing is sincerity in devotional advancement, spiritual advancement. The whole thing is sincerity. Then you will be automatically guided by Guru and Krishna. How did you all come in contact with the movement? Especially those who have become more serious. You know, you did not know Prabhupada was a bona fide spiritual master. Although Prabhupada always says you have to search out for a bona fide spiritual master. How are we going to search out for a bona fide spiritual master? How do we know who is a bona fide spiritual master to even search him out? We have to know the lakshanam of a bona fide spiritual master. What is the symptoms of a bona fide? We don't even know anything. How did we even come in contact? Because there was some sincere desire to advance in this direction. So Paramatma, he saw that and he directed us to the proper spiritual master. Why is many people go to cheating gurus? Why they end up there? Because they want to be cheated. You can blame the cheater, but also, why did they end up there? Because they wanted to be cheated. They want some spiritual process by which they can attain easily material benefits. Or they want some yoga, something not devotion to Krishna. They are not sincere in that respect. They want something else out of their process. So then they will be directed to the cheaters. So both are to be blamed. The cheater is a rascal. The one who is cheated is also a rascal. So but if one is sincere, one is directed to the proper spiritual master. In this way, develop a desire to attain me. Okay, I'll just go to this one and come back.
Naivopayantyapachitim kavayastavesha brahma yushapikritam riddhamudasmarantaha yontar bahistanubhritam ashubhan vidhunman acharya chaitya vapusha svagatim yanakti.
This is from the Srimad Bhagavatam 11.29.6. 11th Canto, 29th chapter, verse 6. O my Lord, this is a prayer to Krishna. Transcendental poets and experts in spiritual science could not fully express their indebtedness to you, even if they were endowed with the prolonged lifetime of Brahma. For you appear in two features, externally as the Acharya and internally as the Super Soul, Paramatma, to deliver the embodied living being by directing him how to come to you. So, for this reason, we cannot repay Krishna's favor at any time, because he comes in both features, internally as Paramatma, externally as the Acharya. When one is pure, he can communicate with the Paramatma just like we can communicate with each other. We can talk to each other like that. We can have conversation with Paramatma. But because we are not on that stage, and because we don't have the qualification to communicate with Paramatma, so the Paramatma comes externally in the form of Acharya and directly tells us what to do. You chant 16 rounds. From Paramatma, we don't get a direct instruction like that. We can get Tene Brahma Hridaya Adhikavaya. He gave it to Brahma because Brahma was pure enough. But because we are not, we cannot communicate with him. The lack is only on our side, never on Krishna's side. So, still, even though we are lacking, he comes as an Acharya. He sends his most confidential servant, who is the pure representative of the Paramatma. In fact, Sakshad Haritvena Samasta Shastraya, he should be taken as good as God. Because, not that he is God, suddenly we will worship him as, you know, God. No, but he is the messenger of God, therefore his message is the same as God. And therefore, he should be given exactly the same respect as one would give God. Once Prabhupada was asked by a reporter, news reporter. Because at that time, Hare Krishna movement was so famous. Wherever he went, the news reporters came. He was like a celebrity. So, news reporter asked Prabhupada, I have seen that you have come in an expensive car. Then Prabhupada said, what is this ordinary motor car for spiritual master? Spiritual master should be worshipped as good as God. What is this ordinary motor car for God? For God, he should be brought in golden car. This is already not up to the mark yet. That woman already was jealous that he has come in such an expensive car. And he just doubled it. But there was no pride in him. It is not that he wanted to go on a golden. First of all, I mean, he was already happy in Vrindavan. Why he took so much, heart attack and everything and went on a ship? How much difficulty he went through? It's not that he wants some comfort, nothing like that. But it is a disciple's duty to treat spiritual master as good as God. As a duty. So to teach the disciple, he will allow himself to be worshipped in that way, but at the same time, immediately transfers all the worship to Krishna. So spiritual master, that's why Prabhupada always translated Guru as, bona fide spiritual master as, a transparent via medium to Krishna. No translucent, not opaque, transparent. Everything that you give to Prabhupada will go directly to Krishna. So, in this way. So when we are not on that stage, the Acharya, will come and tell us what to do, what not to do. Direct us. Going back again. Next verse. So here it is said, follow the regulative principles, the rules and regulations. Now next. 12.10. Abhyasepi asamarthosi. If you cannot even do this abhyasa practice, matkarma paramo bhava, madartham api karmani kurvan siddhim avapsyasi. So try to understand, this is in the context of today's verse, that if one should not be encouraged to stop his work, but to be encouraged in the spirit of devotion. So that is what we are coming to. So if one cannot maintain that standard, okay, at least this, then at least follow the regulative principles if you don't have attachment for Krishna. If you cannot even follow the regulatory principles, okay, now this is the next verse. If you cannot practice the regulations of Bhakti Yoga, then just try to work for me, because by working for me, you will come to the perfect stage. Work for me means Karma Yoga. Okay, I am not able to surrender my life. I am working somewhere, I have commitments. I cannot come out immediately. So, okay, part of the results of our work, we have to give to Krishna. So, when one earns his income, there is actual standard of Vedic life that 50% of the income should be given to Krishna consciousness movement. 50%. The rest, yes, we have to distribute among personal emergencies, relatives and, you know, our day-to-day life expenditures. So, this is how actually we should think, that everything is for Krishna. So, at least work, and if you have some talents, use that for Krishna. Suppose, photographer, somebody is a good photographer. Come and take pictures of the deities, pictures of festivals, you know. So, that is also, whatever you have, talent, any skill, so you can use that for Krishna. And if you don't know how to use it for Krishna, take guidance from devotees. They will know how to engage. Those who are following the spiritual master nicely, they can engage you. Okay? Then, next, 12:11. Athaitadapya asaktosi kartum madhyogam ashrita sarva karma phalatyagam tatah kuryo yatatmavan. If however you are unable to work in this consciousness of me, then try to act by giving up all the results of your work and try to be self-situated. So if you don't have devotion for me, so at least whatever you are doing, try not to be too much attached to the results of that work. Try to detach yourself. But actually this is very difficult. To be very honest, this is very difficult. So, because if you don't have the devotion to Krishna, everything else becomes difficult. All these other methods, if they are used in conjunction with devotional service, then they become easier. Because we have to get a higher taste of Krishna consciousness to be able to give up that lower taste of material enjoyment. If we don't have a footing in the higher taste of Krishna consciousness, we cannot effectively, go away from material enjoyment. We cannot remove that anchor of material enjoyment from our heart. We have to be, that's why it is said, you see, our process is not to artificially control. If my senses are craving for meat, oh, I should control, you know, I'm a devotee. No, that's not the way. A devotee, even if he was previously eating meat, when he gives up and becomes a devotee, it is not that his heart is still craving, oh, I miss that, you know, whatever meat it was. I don't even want to say that on this chair. But, you know, I miss that dish, you know, I miss this. No, he is not missing that. He is completely disgusted with that because he has such a higher taste now. Higher understanding of life. Not taste means only the tongue. Tongue also, he has no, he can't. In fact, we have experience, devotees, they can't even smell that again. They can't even smell that again. Even those who were accustomed to eating meat before. So, that is the physical level, but also in the mind, you will think, how can I kill these poor animals? And he will also think that, even if he has no compassion, he will start to understand in the beginning stages, oh, I will have to become these animals next life and I have to also be killed. Oh, better not. This is how Mrigari became a devotee. You know, a hunter who was hunting and then Narad Muni made him a devotee. He said, don't kill like this, you know. No, but my father taught me. Because he was half killing. He was expert in half killing the animals. It is easy to, I mean it's not easy, but to shoot an arrow and kill an animal, that is, okay, you can consider him a very skilled hunter. But he was even more skilled, this Mrigari. He used to shoot the arrow on the animal in such a way that the animal will not die. But it will suffer, it will be, you know, struggling for existence. He will shoot like that. He is so expert. Every animal, however fast, however adept it is at moving, he will shoot the animal in such a way that it will only half die. And it will suffer for a long time before it dies. And he learned his art from his father. And he is proud of that. Because no other hunter could do it like him. So when Narad Muni said, what are you doing? When he saw all the animals, then he followed the trail of all the half-killed animals and he found this Mrigari. Why are you killing like this? My father taught me like this. It's our tradition and I'm the best in my family. Do you know that you also have to be these animals next life? And how many animals you have killed, that many animals, all those animals you have to become. And you have to be killed in the same way, my dear sir. Really? Because we are only self-interested. We are not interested for, in the beginning at least. We are not interested in others' welfare so much. Even if we are, that is very feeble. We are self-interested. So, therefore even Bhagavad Gita also starts at that point. Oh, you are suffering. Because you are not the body. He is not, the first instruction is not that, you know, you have to surrender to Krishna. No, nobody is interested in Krishna here in this material world. Nobody is interested. They just want to solve their own problems. Even if they come to temple, it's not that they are interested in God. They are interested, if God can solve my problem, I will come to the temple. If I can solve my problems another way, I will go there. You know? If I pray to God and God does not solve my problem, that means finish. I am not going to come to this temple anymore. This is the kind of mentality people usually have. So, that is not the proper way. Whether God, you know, protects me or kills me, He is always my Lord. That is highest. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu prayed like that. But in the beginning, we are always interested in ourselves. So, Bhagavad Gita starts there and Mrigari also was advised like that. Oh, then he understood, oh, it is not about only compassion for the animals. Even if one does not have, at least do you have compassion for yourself? Start there first. As they say, what is that? Charity begins at home. Charity at home is no charity. I mean, you give your family members, as hardly any charity that is. It's still selfishness because you are giving your own family members. But they say, at least there is some, you know, other than you are giving to somebody else. You know, they say like that. So, at least if you don't have compassion for the animals, do you have for yourself even? That's why there is one verse where it is said that those who are demoniac, they work on the platform of self-envy. Self-envy. That means they envy themselves. Envy in the sense, they hate themselves. Because if I really, people actually, who hates themselves? Nobody. Right? So everybody wants to be doing good to themselves. But those who are demoniac, those who do not follow the scriptural rules and regulations, what are they doing? They are committing sins and they are just bringing suffering upon themselves by doing so in the future. So actually they are bringing themselves harm. The guy who is smoking, what is he doing? He is harming himself. First of all, he is wasting his money buying the cigarette. Second, his body is getting messed up. Later again, he has to pay more in the hospital bills. Not only he has to pay, his family members have to, you know, chip in everything. He is bringing problems to himself and others. He is just bringing problems. So, what good is he doing? Similarly, actually everybody, if we are not Krishna conscious, we are as good as the, this is called Atmahatya, suicide. We are actually committing suicide. Having obtained this human body, if we are not making any solution for the stoppage of our repeated birth and death, we are acting on the platform of spiritual suicide. So not only the smokers or, you know, anybody who is not interested in Krishna consciousness, he is working on the self-envy platform, self-hate. So it all starts there. So if you are really interested in yourself, then start on this path. So if you can, one cannot then do this at least. If you cannot do this, okay, do at least this. You know, like that Krishna is coming down. So that at least we have a starting point first. Yes, we know the end point is like complete surrender and always thinking of Krishna and fully in love with Him. That is, you know, that is ultimate. But we are not there. So where we can start? According to our mentality, He is giving us the directions. So, if however you are unable to work in this consciousness of Me, then try to act by giving up all the results of your work and try to be self-situated. So after this, He goes back again. He's still one more. 12:12. If you cannot take to this principle, then engage yourself in the cultivation of knowledge. Better than knowledge, however, is meditation, and better than meditation is renunciation of the fruits of action. For by such renunciation, one can attain peace of mind. If you cannot take to this practice, then at least engage yourself in the knowledge, cultivation of knowledge. So because why one does not want to follow all these things? Because he does not have knowledge. He is ignorant of what is the aim of life. So cultivate knowledge first. And then better than knowledge, however, is meditation. Because the fruit of knowledge, that means we have to be meditating on Krishna. That is the higher stage. And meditation means we have to let go of our material habits, material, aham mamata. When we think that this is mine, I am the doer. All this have to be gone. So that is called renunciation of the fruits of action. So in this way, one is advised to follow this path. Then again, he goes back to the symptoms of a pure devotee again. So this is another. But this is the point. So we always come to the point of the end of this class. But although this verse, today's verse says that, you know, do not disrupt, let not the wise disrupt the minds of the ignorant who are attached to fruitive action. They should not be encouraged to refrain from work but to engage in work within the spirit of devotion. This does not mean, however, that we do not engage with people to help them. A devotee, one who is preaching Krishna consciousness, one who is trying to get this message across to those people who are lost in this world, everybody is lost. So a devotee always tries, he is never happy going to the Himalayas and meditating on the Lord. No, he is not happy. He thinks, why should I alone just meditate? No. Why? The millions of people are suffering. So therefore, he goes to the busiest part of the world. He does not romanticize, the beautiful Himalayas, the beautiful scenery. No. He's not interested. Yeah, I am enjoying. What about the other people? They are suffering. No, I want to help them. Prahlad Maharaj said that. All these are, whatever we are saying here, is upheld by the scriptural quotations, not of my words. Prayena deva munaya svavimukti kaman maunam charanti vijanena pararthanishthah naitan vihaya kripanan vimamuksha eko nanyam dvadasya sharanam brahmato nupashye. Jai Sri Sri Radha Madan Mohan. Prahlad Maharaj, you know, everybody knows Prahlad. He is saying to Narasimhadev, my dear Lord Narasimhadev, I see that there are many saintly persons indeed, but they are interested only in their own deliverance. Not caring for the big cities and towns, they go to the Himalayas or the forest to meditate with vows of silence, Maunavrata. They are not interested in delivering others. As for me, however, I do not wish to be liberated alone, leaving aside all these poor fools and rascals. I know that without Krishna consciousness, without taking shelter of your lotus feet, one cannot be happy. Therefore, I wish to bring them back to shelter at your lotus feet. This is the compassion of devotee. So, although the population is averse to the Lord, they are not interested in the Lord, they are against. But still he will go, and even at the risk of his own life, he will go to preach. We have the examples of Haridas Thakur. We have the example in the Western world of Jesus Christ. He was crucified, but he never stopped preaching. Even when he was being nailed, he was praying to God, oh God, please forgive them, they do not know what they are doing. You know, that is a Vaishnav. That is a Vaishnav. He tolerates all kinds of pain from the people who he is preaching to and still continues to preach at the risk. So this may be considered, for the atheist, they will consider him a disturbance, a preacher, to be a disturbance. Ah, he's always talking about this, you know, sin and all these things. He's not letting me enjoy. There was a court case. One of the devotees in America, she was born into the Hare Krishna movement because her parents were devotees, because Prabhupada went there. So when she grew up to be an adult, she was not so interested in Krishna consciousness. But all the words of, you know, this sin, you know, this intoxication, meat eating and gambling and illicit sex, this is all sinful life. And because in Western culture, that is their culture, that is the pillar of life. These four are pillars of life. Meat eating, illicit sex, gambling, intoxication are what their life is built on. If you say that these are all sin, and so it's like, you know, what should I do then? It's like that for them. So this lady actually went to the complaint. You know, there was a court case. She said, I am being haunted by these thoughts. I am not able to enjoy my life. And she filed a court case against the ISKCON. I mean, Hare Krishna devotees. That I am not able to enjoy my life because of them. They have brainwashed me in such a way that always this sin is coming in my head. I am not able to freely eat meat, not able to freely intoxicate. You see how she is looking at it. So for them it's a disturbance to, you know, to hear all these things. They want to not be disturbed in their stupid sense gratification. You know? So for them, a devotee is an enemy. But for devotee, he actually is trying to help them. So once Prabhupada was, the devotees told him that he just arrived in the temple from the airport. So on the wall near the temple, you know, they did some vandalism. They wrote, you know, something against the Hare Krishna devotee, to hell with them, or something they said, you know, they wrote on the wall. So the devotees try to cover that so that Prabhupada does not see that, you know. So because they don't want him to come into a bad mood, you know. Oh, this is how Hare Krishna is there in the country. So I had to hide it, you know. But second day or third day, he saw. Oh, people are disturbed. Then our movement is successful. Because that means they have heard it. They have heard the chanting and they were disturbed. So the holy name went into their ears. The purification has started for them. Never mind, whatever they say. But the holy name has entered. That's why they are disturbed. That means our movement is successful. We have penetrated. So the neighbors, one similar thing. Neighbors were complaining in another place. The neighbors were complaining. Oh, they are very loud, you know. Police complained, police came and all that. So these stories also Prabhupada came to know. The devotees told him, you know, the neighbors are very always, you know, disturbed by our chanting. That's good. You know, they're disturbed means they have heard it. So this is how Prabhupada looked at it. So how to reconcile with this verse that do not disrupt their minds? So a devotee is so compassionate. It is said that a devotee is even more compassionate than Krishna. Krishna said, you know what? Of course, we cannot preach to the faithless. But unless we start preaching, how do we know whether somebody is even faithful or faithless? It's like they say, chicken and egg, catch 22 situation. Which one is first? How do we know that he is faithless? Unless we start speaking to him, and if he is really against it, okay, fine, you do whatever you want. But if he is innocent, and he doesn't know, and if you tell him, then he starts to listen, oh yeah, okay, I will follow. And that's good. So unless you start speaking to him, you do not know. So a devotee always reaches out. So in the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna said, idam te natapaskaya na bhaktaya kadachana na cha shushrushave vachyam na cha mama yobhya suyati. This confidential knowledge may never be explained to those who are not austere or devoted or engaged in devotional service, nor to one who is envious of me. Krishna is saying, don't preach to these kind of people. But devotee is so compassionate that he will go the extra mile to help them. Even if that means disturbance, even if that means death to him, like Jesus Christ was nailed on the cross. Even to that extent, titikshava Karunika. Two things simultaneously. He is Titikshava, he is very, very tolerant. It's not that, oh, I preach to you, how you can do like this to me. No, no, no. Even if you kill me, never mind. So he's tolerant. Of course, it is not good for one who does like that, who actually kills the preacher or tries to harm the preacher. You know, not that, oh, I will harm this preacher and see how much he is a devotee. Oh, he's getting angry, oh, that means what kind of preacher he is. Let's see what happened to this kind of people. Some people do that, you know, I'm not joking, some people actually do that. When we are preaching, when we are distributing books, some guy will come and talk some nonsense, you know, against Krishna consciousness, against Krishna. And so when we are arguing with him, quoting all the references and everything, then of course, you know, a devotee, when Krishna is disrespected, he will get angry. If he himself is disrespected, he will not get so angry. He will think, okay, I'm anyway a rascal. I'm not a very great guy. I'm a useless fellow. So, but when somebody says Krishna is he's a lusty fellow, you know, people talk like this. You know, then devotee gets angry. Of course, he tries to prove him. Then some people have no intelligence to accept. So devotee, if you see Prabhupada, with Indians, almost every time he's angry when they ask questions. Because they ask not to learn, but to challenge. In America, I did not have this problem. They were genuinely wanting to know. But in India, many times, they half know something and they try to, you know, tell Prabhupada what, where he was wrong and where he is, you know, try to test him. Always, if you see the recordings, audio recordings of Prabhupada's lectures, towards the end of the lecture, there's a question-answer session. The Indians will ask question, always some argumentative questions. And Prabhupada always had to get angry at them. So sometimes when we also get angry with these people, they say, oh, see what kind of sadhu you are, what is dress you are wearing and why you are getting angry, you have no control of your senses. Immediately. So this is their aim. Just to show that, you know, oh, you are getting angry, so you are not qualified. They are not interested to learn anything. But then, so we always tell them, so do you think Hanuman is a useless person? He got angry, right? He got angry, so angry that it burned the whole Lanka. He could have burned everything, but he kept it for Ram. So Hanuman was angry. But he was not angry because he was offended. He was angry because Ram and Sita were offended. That is the anger. So anger also can be used in Krishna's service against those who are against Krishna. So there is use of everything. Ayushriyam yashodharmam lokan asisha evacha hanti shreyamsi sarvani pumso mahadatikramaha. My dear king, when a man persecutes great souls, all his benedictions of longevity, beauty, fame, religion, blessings and promotion to higher planets will be destroyed. So don't think, I know. So don't think that one can get away with all these things. Oh, I will test the sadhu. No. Then we will go to hell. All these blessings, everything will go away. So last reference. This is how a devotee thinks. Kastvam kastam svayam tad abhignyo vipaschid avidyayam antarevartamanam drishtva punastam sanghrana kubuddhim prayojayed utpathagam yathandham. If someone is ignorant and addicted to the path of samsara, how can one who is actually learned, merciful and advanced in spiritual knowledge engage him in fruitive activity and thus further entangle him in material existence? If a blind man is walking down the wrong path, how can a gentleman allow him to continue on his way to danger? How can he approve this method? No wise or kind man can allow this. So this is how a devotee sees. It's not that, oh, let me not disturb, then let them go to hell, you know. Let me not disturb them going to hell. No. Hare, they are going to hell, let me save them. Even though they may feel disturbed. For the time being, but they will thank me later. Even if they don't thank me, doesn't matter. I'll do my part to help them. So this is how a devotee thinks. Alright, we'll stop here. Any questions or comments? Actually, we don't have time to discuss now questions and comments. I ran 10 minutes, almost 15 minutes late. We have a drama, in fact, a very short drama, after which we'll have prasadam. So we'll just see if there's any online questions. Somebody is saying you can get high on Milo. Yeah, it's chocolate, you know. Intoxication. So yeah, so we'll stop here then. Granth Raj Srimad Bhagavad Gita ki, Srila Prabhupada ki, Tai Gaur Premanande.